something for the good of the order?
Yes, I have to make a correction. Last week I told you that food pantry serves 600 families, it's 300 families. Double the numbers, not intentionally, but we still need the brown paper bags, and we just use 600, and just two per family. Okay? Thank you.
Yes, and one in the back there?
Yes, tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, we're having AED and CPR training at the ambulance garage behind the hospital in Ocala Falls. I do have a sign-up sheet out there, but it's open to anybody, and if you just decide that tomorrow, that you'll be able to make it, don't worry about having to sign up. Mostly so we wouldn't go over 30 people, and we're not anywhere near that. So if you're interested in coming, it's not card certification or anything, it's just what to do in an emergency situation. I was involved in one several months ago, and I was just glad that we had people there who it was in a place I didn't know where the AED was or anything, but people jumped into action, and we lost the guy for a while, but we ended up saving his life, so it's some very worthwhile training. So tomorrow night, 6 o'clock at the ambulance garage. I'll be here around after 5 o'clock, and if anybody wants to carpool, they can come with me, and I will leave here at about 5:30.
Yes.
You may have noticed we have a phone booth, and this is for our vacation Bible school that's going to start in July. I was reading the announcements, and it did have the time. The time is from 5 o'clock to 7 o'clock. So if you know students in the neighborhood that need some activity and some Christian education, sign up for our vacation Bible school. Our theme is Jesus is calling us to. We're going to explore just what that to means for the students and their families. So hope to see students.
Well, it's good to know that we have another possibility from our cell phones here. My sisters, I have four sisters and I, we would always get a quarter from our parents if we went away on an event so we could use the phone booth. That brings back memories. Any other announcements? If not, please rise as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Let us now in silence reflect and examine ourselves and so prepare to confess our sins. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at our table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us from our dangers. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves.
Amen.
Our opening hymn is All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, verses 1, 2, and 3. Thank you. ruler of all hearts, you call us to obey you, and you favor us with true freedom. Keep us faithful to the ways of your Son, that leaving behind all that hinders us, we may steadfastly follow your paths. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated.
From 1 Kings chapter 19. Then the Lord said to Elijah, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholiah, as prophet in your place." So he set out from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, who was plowing. There were 12 yoke of oxen ahead of him, and he was with the 12. Elisha passed by him and threw his mantle over him. He left the oxen, son of Elisha, and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." Then Elisha said to him, "Go back again. For what have I done to you?" He returned from following him, took the yoke of oxen, and slaughtered them. Using the equipment from the oxen, he boiled their flesh and gave it to the people to eat. Then he set out and followed Elisha and became his servant. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
go like this. Maybe your neighbor's dog has been barking outside of your bedroom window early on in the morning for the past 10 years. Or perhaps your neighbor has let the trees grow up and get to interfere your view, and they won't cut them down. Or perhaps your neighbor allows old cars parked around their house and just junks up the neighborhood, maybe even reduces property values while you're still paying high taxes on the property. And so you have these deep, long-term feelings inside. Maybe even a little incident can set it all off. We know about long-standing conflicts between religions, between Muslims and Jews, between Catholics and Protestants, between Christians and Muslims, between Christians and Jews, between Sunnis and Shiites. There are long-standing conflicts between nations, the French and the English, Germany and the rest of Europe, the Serbs and the Croatians, the Indians and the Pakistanis. The list goes on and on. Well, this is the mood and awareness that we approach the gospel lesson for today. It is a story about a little incident that explodes because of a long-seated historical conflict. It's sort of a little-known story in the scripture. It's only found here in the Gospel of Luke. And it's the kind of story which sometimes could even be forgotten. But I'm really glad that it's there in our pericopes, pericopes meaning the common lectionary. We only have it, of course, once every 3 years, but it really expands to a lot of subjects that are very contemporary, probably contemporary in any era, people who read this account in Luke. Well, the story is this. Jesus was going up north in Galilee, and then he was getting ready to go down south to Jerusalem. It says he set his face to Jerusalem. Of course, that's the holy city. And he had to pass through Samaria. You have Galilee up here, you have Samaria here, you have Judea down here on the map. Now, you probably have heard of the Samaritans. You've heard of the Good Samaritan parable. And about the Samaritan woman, the woman at the well. You know, there's other accounts in scripture about those people in Samaria. It didn't take much for Jews to get set off against the Samaritans because they didn't like them very much. They didn't intermingle with them. They didn't intermarry with them. They didn't chit and they didn't chat with them, one person said. So when Jesus was going on this pilgrimage from the north to the south, he had to go through Samaria and parts of Samaria. The Samaritans and the Jews even harassed each other on the road, it said. There was that long-standing conflict. Who knows the origins of it? Some people said it went back about 100 years before this time in Scripture, when the Jews had burned down the Samaritan's temple. That would probably cause some animosity. But it may have gone back all the way up to the time of Moses and Joshua, when they were going into the Promised Land, there were these people that had intermarried with the heathen Canaanites. And they, in time, became called the Samaritans. Jewish people, called them half-bred Jews. They weren't two true blue Jews. They were half-breeds in their eyes. And so, both of those incidents could have been the animosity, maybe even something else. So, Jesus was ready to go down south, and he had to go through Samaria, and he sent some disciples in front of them to make preparations. First, we don't see who they are. But then we find out, it's the brothers. It's James and John. Now, I have served a church called St. James Lutheran Church in Pittman, Pennsylvania. You happen to be St. John's. It's this man that your church is named after,
thunderous personalities. So maybe those weren't the best people to go ahead. These people who had thunderous tempers, thunderous prejudices. But Jesus sent down the sons of thunder. And so James and John went to this small Samaritan village. They came to this little town on the road where prejudices had run deep and real for maybe 100 years or more. And they went to that town, and the text says that they were not sufficiently welcomed. Oh man, this set the two hotheads off. Just a little thing. They were not properly welcomed. And that set the two of them off. Well, it didn't take much to set James and John off. It didn't take much to make them mad. And so they came up to Jesus, who had just entered the villages, and said, "Do you want us to call down the fires of hell and burn these people up?" Ooh, wow. Is this a little going overboard or what? But there was a precedent about this. The man that we hear about in the first lesson, Elijah, had done something just like that, had called down the fires of heaven to burn up those 400 priests of Baal. Sometimes it's pronounced Baal, the heathen god of the time of Ahab and Jezebel. Hardly anybody names their daughter Jezebel these days, for good reasons. She was the person that set up these 400 false priests, heathen priests. And so at that time, they were consumed by fire from heaven. And so James and John pick up this incident from the Old Testament. Let's burn them up, since they didn't welcome us. Sort of an overreaction, if you would ask me. Why don't we have a big explosion here, they're saying. However, Jesus right away rebuked them. That is James and John. Maybe even some of the other disciples felt the same way, but it's really pointed at them. And he says, "This is not my spirit, for the Son of Man came not to destroy, but to save others." William Barclay, the great English theologian, said that this passage in the Bible, although not well known, teaches tolerance like no other passage in the Bible. This passage is the best passage in the Bible that teaches tolerance of others. You know, quick anger can come at any time. It happens all the time. It happens with parents. It happens with children. It happens between neighbors. Happens between regions. It happens because of long-standing prejudices and misunderstandings and long-standing traditions even. The feelings of the prophet Elijah in the Old Testament had a time where he was a beacon for righteousness against a really, really bad time of darkness. If ever there was the Dark Ages in the Old Testament time, it was that period of Elijah where the light of God's ways was almost ready to be extinguished altogether. Yes, Elijah called down the fires of God from heaven to wipe out the 400 prophets of Baal. But Jesus would never do that. That's one of the crucial differences between the Old Testament and the New Testament, between Elijah and Jesus. There is an enormous difference between the era, time, and also between the two individuals. I think the best commentary on this passage is a story from Abraham Lincoln, who many people think was the finest and the most spiritual of our presidents. During the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln was being criticized for not being harsh enough and severe enough on the soldiers of the South, you know, the Confederate soldiers. And one time after a battle, a general up to him and said, "Why don't you just destroy your enemy? Why don't you just wipe them out altogether?" And President Lincoln answered with those famous words, "Do not destroy my enemy by making him my friend." I think that's where the Word of God really touched Abraham's heart. Do I not destroy my enemy by making him my friend? Boy, that's a great quotation. That could be really there in Scripture. What a wonderful insight. What an amazing saying that comes from one of our presidents. You talk about Vacation Bible School coming up here. I remember we had a Vacation Bible School week. Well, actually, it was 2 weeks back then. Back in the 50s and 60s, we went for 2 weeks for Vacation Bible School, I think 9 to 3 each day of the week. And that year, I remember, we had 10 commandments was our subject matter. And Hilda Eastland, she was one of my best friend's mothers. We all had our mothers one time or another for Vacation Bible School. They took turns. We even had our sisters. Oh, that was worse. Sometimes they were the assistant teacher, not the main teacher. But I remember Hilda Eastland, she had us make each of us, all 10 of the commandments, we had to contemporize the 10 commandments. How would you, contemporize, honor your father and mother? I think mine was, listen to your parents, okay? And we did that on the scrimshaw, I think. Ever done that? It was like we put the letters down on the construction paper, and then we would have paint, and then there would be a screen, and then we'd do spray painting, and it would come out, and we'd take the letters off, and then it would say, like, listen to your parents. Okay, the one I remember for thou shalt not kill was, I was thinking through that, let's see, what should I do for thou shalt not kill, contemporize it, and I said, kill them with kindness. That was my meaning of the Ten Commandments. You and I all know the feelings of anger and resentment. They run deep in our hearts. We many times have deep, deep feelings of resentment against people. And yet here in our passage, there is an allusion to, thinking through this resentment. Sometimes we are the ones that get hurt the most from this. We think it's the other person that we're hurting, but sometimes it's us that get hurt the most in the resentment that eats us up inside and doesn't go towards any reconciliation, any appeasement, any even like the times of war, any time of coming to the peace table at all. Now there's the second part two of the sermon for today. You're going to get kind of two sermons today, because there's two parts here today. And the other part, in some ways you think, does this even relate to the first part? Does this one even have anything to do with the first part? But you'll see, it does. If you look kind of deep in this. Okay, now in the gospel story today, after Jesus left the Samaritan village and went on his way to Jerusalem, three people came up to Jesus and they wanted to be his disciples. That happens all the time. There's something very attractive about Jesus of Nazareth. And when people get acquainted with Jesus of Nazareth, their immediate reaction often is that they want to be his disciples. They are wannabes. We all
because to be a disciple of Jesus takes a greater commitment than they're maybe willing to give. And so in the text for today, the first wannabe comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, I want to be your disciple. I will leave everything to follow you. And then Jesus says, you don't understand what you're saying, what you're asking for. For foxes have holes and birds have nests, but I have nowhere to lay my head at night. That's what's in the front of our bulletin for today. There's the fox there going towards the hole. There's the bird going towards the nest. We have a nest, I think it's like wrens outside our window these days. It's really fun to see the mama and the daddy wren taking such good care of the little ones inside. And someday though, they get pushed out and it's even like cement down below in our patio. Boy, they really got to know the right timing when they push them out of the nest. I've seen a number of foxes, and mostly at night going across the road and so on. I don't think I've ever seen a fox a hole as such. But each of them is a really great example here about the way in which Jesus really had nowhere to lay his head. He had no home after that home. Nazareth. He was the guest. And you know, when we have that table grace or table prayer, come Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let these gifts to us be blessed. You know, we're reminded that Jesus is the guest. He was the guest, and he's going to be our guest in our home. Because in some ways he's homeless. And so we need to welcome him into our home. Then the second wannabe says to Jesus, I would love to be your disciple, but first I need to bury my father. My father and my grief is very important to me. And Jesus replied, let those who are dead bury the dead. Ouch. The kingdom of God is more important than your grief over the death of your father. Wow, it gets even more intense, doesn't it, here, the second response? And then the third wannabe came to Jesus and said, Jesus, I would love to be your disciple, but I must first say goodbye to my family. I love my family, and I must first say goodbye to my family. And then Jesus says, a person with his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. You can't plow a straight line if you're constantly looking back. To plow a straight line, you've got to keep your eyes out in front. You've got to keep your focus out front. And if you're going to be my disciple, you can't constantly be looking back, even at your family. If you're always looking back at your family, you're not fit to be a part of the kingdom of God. Now it gets even more intense. Now that mentioning of the plow is something that we heard already in the first lesson, didn't we? From Elisha,
probably the overarching thing was that he left his profession to go to be with his master in many ways, Elijah, and he will become a successor to Elijah, Elijah and Elisha. Well, if we do it for today's language, not too many of us here in the room have plowed with oxen. I just almost bet nobody here. Have you even plowed with horses? Anybody here? My dad plowed with horses, yes, in the 20s and 30s. We had a team of horses that I knew in my youth. We used them only for bucking up hay. We had an Iowa hay bucking. That was like slough hay. It was like areas of the farm where it was kind of treacherous. We lived along the Sioux River in northwest Iowa. And so we, once in the summer, we would get that hay from the sloughs. And it was so good to do it with tractors because you kind of tip the tractor over. So we went with the work horses that were still on our farm. Oh, one of the worst days in my dad's life was when he had to sell Red and Flicka, the workhorses. Whoa! He had spent so much time with them, and any of you who know a horse, you know, you get so attached to them, and where were those horses going? Not out to pasture, probably to the factory. And so, you know, I know a little bit about this, of plowing with horses. But my dad couldn't just be looking behind him all the time, you know, in plowing. Your plowing would go all over the place, and you wouldn't get it done. And so maybe he would use the word tractor, or maybe even car for us. If you're constantly looking in the back seat to your family, and you're driving in heavy traffic, wow, would you have an accident quickly? Would you get to your place, maybe at all? So just contemporizing it in our own day and age. Okay, now let's look about the three issues here. The first one, the question, can we love our homes, apartments, living spaces too much? Sometimes it can get in the way. Our possessions of our devotion to our Lord and Savior. Faith Popcorn, what a funny name. Faith Popcorn is an American sociologist, a thinker, and she came up with a phrase called cocooning. Cocooning is, it's my castle, my house, my condo, my apartment. I'm in there, safe from struggles and the evil in the world. I'm cocooning. And for some people, that is their life. They get so attached to the home that they don't think of anybody else but the home and them. Now, what's the opposite of that, of a cocoon? A nest. A nest. Here we have the allusion to another parable of our Lord. This is also, you know, related to our passage here in Luke. This parable, Jesus invited numerous people to the party, to the banquet, to a great ballroom, and the people had numerous excuses why they couldn't come. The first person said, you know, I'd love to come, but I just bought a new field. Contemporary way would say, you know, I just got a new job, and this new job of mine is so time consuming, my job is so time consuming, I just don't have time for you. The you here is Jesus. The second person said, oh Jesus, I'd love to come to your party, but I just bought 5 new oxen. Well, contemporizing it, I just bought a camper. I just bought a new boat. I mean, you know, I got a lot of work to do on that. Put it down in teenager language. I'm a teenager. I have track, I have soccer, I have swimming, I have baseball. I have all these really wonderful things that are really important to me. You know, I just don't really have time for you. What's the you? Jesus. And then the third would-be disciple said, you know, I chuckle because it's so appropriate to so many of our family situations. Oh, we'd love to come to your party, but we just got married, and we have to go finish our apartment, we have to get our furniture, we have to get our apartment decorated, we have to get our home redone. We're so busy being married that we just don't have time for you. The you mean Jesus. Those of us who have been pastors, okay, I've done a minimum of 150 weddings in 41 years plus. Okay. I've said, I now pronounce you man and wife. And for a while that was what I used to say, but we say now, I now pronounce you husband and wife. A little change there, later on in the 70s. Okay. I spent a lot of time with this couple, you know, in counseling, you know, before the wedding. It was so Christ-centered, and there were scripture readings, and there was Christian songs, and there was Christian music, and all of that. And then 1 month later, did I see the couple? 1 year later, did I see the couple? 2 years later, did I see the couple? Had they ever even met with our church? Did I see the couple? Oh, this is a sadness. This is a sadness. And so, this story, I think, speaks about our contemporary time, and probably any time. Happened back in Jesus' day, happens in our time. Okay, this is a final quote from Dr. George Carr. Really wonderful quotation. The most difficult choices in life are not primarily between good and evil, but the most difficult choices in life are between what is good and what is best. Home, children, family, jobs. They're good, they're great, they're wonderful. They're absolutely wonderful. But the best is Jesus in the long run. And for eternity, the long run is Jesus our Lord. The best is the love of God. The best is the kingdom of God. The best is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The best is doing the work of God in the world. The best is taking care of all of God's family, because we believe in the family of God. It's even more than our own nuclear family. The best is taking care of all of God's family in the neighborhood, in the region, in the state, yeah, even in the world. All things of life that we just mentioned are good. These things mentioned in Scripture. But the best of all is our Lord and Savior. Be the disciple of the Lord and Savior. Keep your eyes on the best. Summarizing our text in one phrase. Keep your eyes on the best. Amen.
faithfulness, set the face of your church firmly on you. Rooted in your self-giving love, may the church find freedom in loving our neighbors. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of gentleness, strengthen the earth's ability to heal. Where there are dangerous storms, bring calm. Where there are destructive fires, bring rain. Protect homes, habitats, and livelihoods threatened by climate disasters. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of peace, guide all who govern, that they place the good of their citizens above self-promotion. Anoint leaders of nations with your spirit of neighborly love. Protect refugees and all who live under tyranny or conflict. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of kindness, reveal your healing presence to all who are sick or dying, especially Ken, Joan, Sherry, Virgil. Uphold those who grieve. Support the needs of any who are unemployed, hungry, or have nowhere to lay their heads. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of love, attend to those struggling with addiction, depression, or uncontrolled anger. Provide support systems and loving companions as they work towards health, that they may rest in hope and know the fullness of joy in your presence. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of joy, we give thanks for all who have died and now celebrate the inheritance of life in you. Keep their examples of faithfulness always before us, that we trust your promises in life and in death. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers, those in our hearts, into your holy keeping. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
And now our offering prayer. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field, and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right at all times and in all places to give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us together pray our Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
Christ's presence, there is fullness of joy. Come to the banquet. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and keep you on to eternal life. His peace be with you. Amen. Let us pray. Life-giving God, through this meal, you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray. Receive the blessing. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you and comfort you and show you the